Welcome to One Song, a podcast we make here at SiriusXM, at Heartbeat Studios. 'Cause I'm Luxxury and you're Diallo. Hell, we're doing here,
making a podcast.
Oh, this episode's about Radiohead and the song. You know, you don't even need me to sing. You already know what the song's gonna be. Or do you? Welcome to One Song.
Luxxury, my man, that was amazing.
Was it though?
No, it was. I always, you know, I think of you mainly like keyboards and all this other stuff, but you're a hell of a guitarist.
You're very kind. You know what? It's very kind of you to say that. We're going to talk about a band today for whom technical proficiency wonderfully is actually not necessarily front and center.
Uh-huh.
So, you know, I played a few chords there. It's true. But one thing I do love about the band we're talking about today is how what they do is playing with sound and ideas, coming out of an era where being Eddie Van Halen was important. They're like, you know what? Let's get past that. You don't have to play a bajillion notes a second.
What's funny is when I first saw the title on our calendar, I was like, oh, we're doing TLC this week.
You weren't like, oh, we're doing Stone Temple Pilots.
I was like, oh, yeah, exactly.
A lot of creeps out there.
When we come in here and we pick songs, usually like it's like, oh man, we're so excited to talk about this song. Today's song kind of has me in a mood a little bit, you know.
It's
a darker song, and I think that I'm absorbing like the a little bit of the energy of the song today.
Right.
Like I got the tude, man.
Yeah,
I feel like I'm like in the '90s,
a little
slackery,
right. But also, it's funny you say that because, like, the band probably feels pretty similarly to you about this song.
Yeah.
Like, it's a great song. They love it, but they're a little tired of it. Throughout their career, as we'll be talking about today, they've had a love-hate relationship.
Yeah, yeah. They didn't even play it for several years.
Yeah. They go on and off many years without playing it.
Well, listen, today's song is an ode to self-loathing, anxiety, obsession, neurosis, self-lacerating rage, and being kind of a creep.
That's right, Diallo. This is a band that went on to be known for far more experimental and challenging music a little bit later.
That's right. I actually often forget that this is them who sing this song because it does
like
not sound
band.
Like them.
It feels like a different band.
Yeah.
Yeah. Interesting, right? And this song is by far and away their biggest hit. It's not even close. It's like 1.5 billion streams. It went double platinum in Italy, Spain, and the UK, 3 times platinum in New Zealand and Portugal, 7 times platinum in Canada. VH1 ranked it one of the best songs of the 90s, and Rolling Stone named it the 118th greatest song of all time.
And if Rolling Stone says it, it's got to be true.
That's your catchphrase.
Yeah,
I think we found it.
That is, yeah. I wouldn't beef with Rolling Stone. I think they stopped publishing a magazine at some point, and then they just started coming out with lists.
And we use those lists all
the
time.
Who's writing
the
list? Who's writing the list this month? Its biggest impact comes from being an alt-rock slacker anthem that helped define the early 90s aesthetic. And I think about this song, and I think about Loser by Beck, and I think about some of the other songs. There are a couple of songs that scream 1990s.
Yeah, they're all of the same moment. You're right. Sort of the post-grunge, post-Nirvana.
Yeah.
Like the thing that changed when Nirvana happened is this.
Yeah, absolutely. But this was, you can say that this is an alternative.
Yeah, right. Alternative's funny because I was there. And that's my new catchphrase.
I was there.
There's a moment in the kind of early 90s when music that wasn't top 40 was called called college rock, right?
Yeah, totally.
So that was what you would listen to on college radio stations, of which I was the music director at my college.
But then it
started to evolve into alt and alternative,
right,
with the rise of the internet and alt dot, you know, those forums. And then it sort of morphed into indie, right? So this is all kind of, those all words all mean the same
thing.
These
words all sort of bounce around. And,
right.
And I think fittingly for anything alternative, the band actually grew to hate this song.
Absolutely.
It felt like
on point.
I think it's been said it felt
message.
Like an albatross around their necks, and they refused to perform it for years,
right? Or even an iron lung, if you will, for shadowing.
This episode of One Song is for all the weirdos. It's Creep by Radiohead. I'm actor, writer, director, and sometimes weirdo Diallo Riddle.
And I'm producer, songwriter, and sometimes creep Luxxury, a.k.a. the guy who talks about interpolation on the internet.
You do.
Okay, so Diallo, Creep drops in 1993. Set the scene for me. Where is young Diallo when you first hear this song?
You know what's interesting? I didn't realize this song came out in 93. I guess the first time I heard it was in high school. But, you know, by the time I, you know, it was probably the summer that I was graduating. So
was it like on the radio or MTV?
Yeah.
The
video was all over MTV. Yeah. This takes me back to a time when videos could, like, really launch a song.
Hell
and people
yeah.
would be, like, talking about
It'd
the video.
Important.
Like,
the video was so important. The
video is so, yeah. so cool. I kind of miss, you know, there being things like an MTV or, you know, even like, you know, KCRW public radio out here. There used to be a lot of places to go to find cool new music.
Right.
And I feel like nowadays with sort of everybody off in their Spotify corner
yeah.
and the algorithm sort of feeding you what it assumes that you like, you know, I don't know that it would know from the songs that I've liked on Spotify that I would love this song, but I do. I do love this
song.
And
it's cool when the discovery, as you were saying, like with MTV specifically or
yeah.
the Box or whatever, like when you've got video, there's mm-hmm. something cool about the discovery happening, like multimedia.
Yeah.
Like, obviously, it's music, so the song is important first and foremost, but the visuals and who the band are, what they look like, can be powerful.
Can
it
be
all
real
makes
powerful.
A big impression.
Yeah, I agree. And by the way, the CDs that you would have in your CD rack back in the day used to say a lot about you. You know, like I used
yeah.
to, you know, some people would alphabetize theirs. I would always like sort of like rank them in my case. And I remember Pablo Honey was in every dorm
right,
room.
Yeah.
yeah. By the time I was in college, Pablo Honey was always there.
Were your CD racks, were they vertical or horizontal though? Like, did
you know what's interesting? I'm thinking about the vertical, but most of the time I just stack the CDs on a drawer or
yeah, because you gotta
dresser.
Be thoughtful. Because if it's vertical, then only the top one's ever gonna get listened to. No one's
totally.
Gonna listen to the one that's 10 down.
How about you? How did you first hear it, and what made it stick out to you musically?
Well, I was gonna say a little foreshadowing is I remember hearing this for the first time in San Francisco where I grew up. I was home from college, and I would have heard it on Live 105, the radio station. Which is an important part of the story we'll be coming back to in a minute. And it's one of those songs that it's memorably, it blows you out of the car. You've got to pull over to listen to it, maybe kind of thing. So I remember very distinctly being like, what is this? Because of the cha-chunk that we'll be talking about soon enough.
I mean, that thing
enough,
is, it
sound,
makes the song.
It makes the song.
Like, I find, like, anytime I hear the song, I'm just kind of waiting for the cha-chunk to show up.
I mean, we were just playing it in the room. Obviously, I just performed it myself. It's like, that is the moment, like, it is the anticipation of that moment, and then the release, the catharsis, is
yeah.
so satisfying. It happens twice in the song, and then you've got to go back and listen again. Maybe you fast forward past the intro, which is a little long, and ka-chunk hits the deepest part of your
It really does. It hits,
soul.
It hits
yeah.
the inner part of my soul, and I want to know everything about it. I'm so happy that we have the stems for this song.
We'll
yeah, I would
in
say.
In a completely new way than you've ever heard it before. Coming
in
up.
A new way. In an absolutely new way.
So in the early 90s, we're talking about a moment where Nirvana has happened.
Yeah.
As we talked about in our Nirvana episode,
uh-huh.
callback, if you haven't listened, go back and listen. Great episode on Smells Like Teen Spirit.
Yeah.
We did a good job,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, I like that episode.
We talk about, though, how the culture changed overnight. Because what Nirvana brought in terms of the sound and the ideas and the attitude, the sort of punk rock energy, and suddenly it's on top 40 radio,
mm-hmm.
changed everything.
Yeah.
And one of the bands in its wake, and frankly, kind of an attitude that starts to happen in the culture in its wake, is this, we got Beck with Loser, we have Creep by Radiohead.
Very similar song,
yeah. mm-hmm.
Loser, because literally this song is like, I'm a creep, I'm a weirdo,
yeah.
and this is... I'm a loser, baby, so why don't you give me... Like,
songs about not having a lot of self-esteem
yeah.
are starting to be a thing, and it's part of this sort of slacker culture. We have the Richard Linklater movie Slacker.
Yeah.
We have Reality Bites with Janine Garofalo. There's this thing happening in the culture where there's a cynicism, there's an irony, there's a kind of like distancing yourself from feeling and emotion to sort of harden yourself. And the irony layer is really interesting to me because... I think we've talked about this on an earlier episode, just sort of touched the surface, but like, you know, David Letterman comes on the scene and he's all about this like knowingness, this tone where what he's saying,
yeah.
you know, is the opposite of what he means,
yeah.
which is kind of a newish thing in pop culture. We've always had cynicism. We've always
yeah.
had irony, but it being something on in the mainstream where you know that something is referring to something else, it's starting to feel a little different to me, I'd say.
Yeah. And I mean, like, you know, this is like when Seinfeld's taking off and like
perfect.
Yeah, all of these things are sort of being created on their own in their own sort of unique creative vacuums. But then taking a look back at this decade as a whole, you're sort of like, oh, there are some through lines here.
Yeah. And it relates to me to Radiohead because a big part of who they are as a band is a band that's come up during the, you know, raised in the 70s and 80s. They've been exposed to a lot of rock and roll and pop music cliches, and they don't want to be it. So when this song becomes a hit and they become this big pop music darling and traveling the world, they have to deal with having their cake and eating it too. To them, they wanted this. They wanted success. But it's not necessarily on their terms. It's not their favorite song in their catalog. No. So it's this very interesting moment of having to be like, are we becoming this cliche that we're trying to rail against?
Well, one other thing I would point out is that, you know, the early and mid 90s have two very different scenes that I feel like Radiohead got lumped in with, sort of against their wishes. But they don't fit in either group. So you have, you know, in America, you have grunge, mm-hmm. obviously, and there is sort of like a grunge element to this song.
There's a connection. I would say that I hear what you're saying. I think the Pixies are what connect. It's that quiet, loud.
Yeah, thing, quiet, loud.
Which we talked about
in
the Nirvana episode. That's definitely the Pixies. That goes into Nirvana. And it's kind of going into Radiohead in parallel. Like they both share doing the quiet verse and the loud chorus, but they don't necessarily share a lot of the other aesthetics.
But you know what else is interesting is that at the same time, so you have grunge, mm-hmm. which, you know, Creep sort of sounds like a grungy song. But then you also have, you know, that explosion of Britpop mm-hmm. happening. And I remember early on, like, Radiohead used to get lumped in with, like, Blur and Oasis and all the other British groups that were, you know, part of this, you know, whatever it was, the third British invasion or whatever. The invasion that didn't really happen because Britpop doesn't really take off in the United States.
It never quite explodes.
It never quite did that.
It gets pretty big, but it's never quite, it doesn't take over the world like Nirvana takes over the world from us to them.
Exactly.
Our export.
But I just find it interesting that, like, Radiohead got lumped in with grunge, got lumped in with Britpop, and it doesn't, and those genres can't be any different.
Yeah.
And Radiohead doesn't fit in either of those genres.
And they never did, ever again, outside of this one song, which barely fits on the album it's from, Paolo Honey, where you don't really have any other songs that sound like it.
Yeah.
So it's just this one song, this one moment.
Imagine being at some of those early Radiohead concerts.
Yeah.
You're just like, I'm just waiting for Creep. I'm just waiting for the cha-chunk.
And the band is just rolling their eyes going, they're just here for Creep. They're just here for the cha-chunk. All right, Diallo, so this song has a pretty interesting story, but before I walk you through that, why don't you walk us through the band's backstory a little bit more?
Yeah, just real quick, I wanted to say a little bit about Radiohead. First off, they took their name, Radiohead, from a Talking Heads song, Radiohead.
That's really
off
cool.
of the True Stories
I totally didn't
album.
Know that.
That's fun. That's
Can
a
we
fun
hear the
fact.
Song?
Yeah, let's hear it. Let's hear a little bit of Radiohead off of True Stories.
That's such a strange choice of a Talking Heads song because I love the Talking Heads. It's not my favorite record.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds so unlike all the like Afrobeat influenced stuff, which is my favorite Talking Heads era. But that's where the band.
That's where they got their name.
That's where Radiohead got their name. That's crazy.
That's kind of wild. Because before they chose that name, they actually were called On a Friday.
Ooh,
and I think the label was like, no, we don't want to do it.
I mean, Radiohead's a pretty bad name, too. It's one of those things that you get used to it over the years, but then when you're like thinking about it, it's like Radiohead. Not great, but love the band.
Tom York, the singer from Radiohead, said that he always liked that song because it's about communication in the ways that, you know, he says it more eloquently than I, but like he's got a really sort of like deep philosophy on why that song means so much
to
him.
I love that.
And so he put them together. They came out with an EP mm-hmm. called Drill. You know, pretty much flops. Like, it doesn't do anything in the UK or, obviously,
Before
in the United
Honey,
States.
Before Pablo Honey, there isn't a P. People don't talk about very much.
But when they decided that they were going to tour America in the hopes that they would use some of that momentum to break them, ironically, in the UK, usually we hear the opposite. We hear, like, oh, we had to take Jimi Hendrix to the UK so that people would book him in America. This is sort of the opposite of that. And they enlist Paul Coltery and Sean Slade because they had worked with the Pixies. I heard you mention earlier, like, oh, yeah, there's a little bit of a Pixies
that
thing going
so
on
much
here.
Sense, yeah.
They produced the debut album, Pablo Honey.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it's interesting because you mentioned Paul Coltery and Sean Slade, the producers who worked together and produced the whole album, Pablo Honey, that Creep is on. You know, most people know Nigel Godrich as being kind of the I was going to say the fifth member, the fifth Beatle, but he's the sixth Beatle of Radiohead, and he's produced all their records after this one. But he wasn't in the picture yet. So the two producers, Coltery and Slade, they were working on songs looking for a single. They were looking to help basically craft the thing that would blow everybody up, including mm-hmm. their own careers. And it's kind of a funny story the way Creep came into the picture. Creep was not one of the songs that they were hired to produce. It wasn't one of the singles in contention, in other words.
Mm.
What happened was during the rehearsals for the songs that are called Inside My Head and Lurgy, by the way, neither of which I think made the cut, Tom York started playing the song he had written at Exeter University in the late 80s.
Wow.
And the whole band knew it because they had been playing it in rehearsals, but they just, to them, it wasn't a serious thing. It was just something to do to goof off.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they were getting sick of the two songs they were playing over and over again. So let's play that other song, that one that Tom wrote. So when they played it, Slade and Coldery like heard it and were like, this is pretty good, you guys. Like, what about this one? This, we think with our producer ears, our American producer ears, and we did the Pixie. So listen to us. We think this could be something. And dismissively, as sort of a joke, Tom York was like, oh, no, that's our Scott Walker song. So Scott Walker, for those who don't know, this incredible singer, very well known kind of in indie circles as like one of these names, one of these artists that never quite break into the mainstream, but like all indie, you know, it's like the Velvet Underground. Only 20 people ever saw them play live, but every single one of them formed a band. It's kind of like Scott Walker. I'm going to play you a little bit of Scott Walker. He's got a beautiful voice. You may hear a little bit of one of Tom York's influences in it.
About to forget the train window girl.
Now, this is a Scott Walker song called It's Raining Today. It's from 1969. There is a connection. This is a beautiful, haunting voice. He's got a really beautiful voice. It almost sounds like a French song to my ears. And then it's got this very strange thing happening in the background with the strings. It's almost dissonant. It's very jarring. And then there's this like sort of beautiful melancholy pop song over it. I mean, foreshadowing to the rest of Radiohead's career after Creep, right? This is something they end up using kind of as a template. So Scott Walker is already in the picture. And what happens is the producers misunderstand. They think that it's a cover. They think that what Tom York has just said is, oh, that's a song that's a cover of a Scott Walker song.
Uh-huh.
And then when it's finally clarified that, no, we just refer to it as that.
Yeah,
as a joke,
it's our Scott Walker song. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Once they realize that this is in contention, that this is a song, a brand new original song, they decide, you know what? We think this is pretty good. Let's record it. They do. And then everyone listens back and they're like, wait a second. We have something special here. Tom turns.
Something very special.
Something
here.
Very, very. I wish I was special.
So very special.
So very special. Tom turns to Johnny, apparently. Tom York, the singer, turns to guitar player Johnny Greenwood after they've listened back and they said, what do you think? And Johnny goes, it's the best thing we've ever done. So interesting that they have.
By the way, if your name is Johnny Greenwood, you have to be a guitarist. Like, that just sounds like a guitarist.
It's a very guitar player name.
Yeah. Nobody wants an accountant named Johnny Greenwood.
He wouldn't be very good at his job. No.
No, it'd be like, hey, man, put down that pen, pick up a guitar, brother.
It's too creative. You're being too creative with the accounting. We only need one book. Don't cook the books. So Coldery, the producer, convinces EMI to release Creep as a single. It goes out in the UK September 21st, 1992, and it flops hard.
Yeah, I did not know
it
this.
It only sells 6,000 copies.
That's crazy.
It gets reviewed very poorly. The London Evening Standard says, quote, a gloomy anthem of self-loathing sprinkled with the F word and a miserable refrain.
I think this is the first song we've ever done that was actually blacklisted by BBC Radio 1.
They played it 3 times and dropped it saying it was too depressing.
Too depressing.
And then the NME, just to add insult to injury and injury on top of the insult, said, pitiful, lily-livered excuse for a rock and roll group.
Dang.
So it does not do well. It peaks at 78 in the UK charts. And they are ready to throw in the towel. I don't know. I don't know what the mood is inside the locker room. But one day they hear that it's becoming a hit in Israel. There's this DJ down there who's sort of the John Peel of Israel who's playing it. It's becoming a hit. Starts spreading. New Zealand, it becomes a hit. Spain, it becomes a hit. And now we kind of come back to the foreshadowing of Blake Robin of Luxury earlier. There's a DJ in San Francisco who is actually a friend of mine. Shout out to Aaron Axelson from Live 105. At the time, he was an intern and a college radio station called KCRH in the Bay Area. He was also interning at Live 105. He buys the record because he's working at a record store, and he listens to it, and he's like, this is amazing. And this is a classic DJ as tastemaker / career maker story, yeah, where he takes it to his boss, Steve Masters at Live 105,
mm-hmm,
says, we should play this. They start playing it. It gets into heavy rotation just on this one radio station, but then other radio stations start to like join in because that's how radio works. It's kind of this phenomenon. Like, wait, this is a hit, getting a lot of attention. The listeners love it. And it spreads up and down the West Coast. It ends up being quite popular in California by the end of the year. In fact, it's number one on Live 105. K-Rock starts playing it. And as we get into 1993, it is starting to spread throughout the U.S. There's this buzz happening.
Yeah.
And just like a little quick anecdote, many years later, again, Aaron Axelson, same DJ who played Radiohead for the first time and broke them in the U.S., he played my music for the first time. So I have him to thank, because that was my pulling over to the side of the road moment when I heard my own music on Live 105 many years later. So I'm very grateful to him. I think Tom York and the boys from Radiohead are grateful in many, many, many more dollars worth of grateful, perhaps. But he deserves his flowers.
I don't know if you'll know this, but when did MTV get into it? Because I feel like, again, I think my first exposure to it was probably through MTV.
This is around the time in early 1993.
Mm-hmm.
So first of all, in February, Pablo Honey, the album, is released, because it is released as a single leading up to the album.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
In hopes that it'll build buzz, which number 78 and 6,000 sales in the UK, it does not build buzz. But in America, the buzz is starting to build. And they did redo that F word, the one that the London Evening Standard complained about. They redid the line, "You're so fucking special," which is still on the album version, but they made a cleaned up version for American radio ears.
You're so very special.
So very special, which sounds so sarcastic. I can just picture him singing that going, "You're so very," it's perfect though for the tone of the
song. You know what's crazy? And we've talked about this on the show before. Sometimes those edits make a song better. Like, I'm not saying like, "So fucking special" is really good.
It's really
but
good.
But "so very special," like there's something nice.
There's
going
something
on
nice
there.
About withholding,
a little bit,
because we haven't even gotten to the ka-chunk yet, and you're already the anger's already there. Let's have a more of a build up, a slow build to the ka-chunk.
Absolutely. I'm reminded of the Snoop Dogg lyric, "I got my gauge, a Uzi, and a motherfucking 22," which for radio became, "I got a gauge, a Uzi, and my nickel plated 22." I always thought better imagery here.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's more specific. Nickel plated.
Yeah. Hold back on some of those F words.
Yeah, come on, Snoop.
It gives them more power.
Snoop, cut back on the F words.
Well, to answer your question, by summer of 93, Creep is a massive alt nation, slacker anthem, if you will, thanks to MTV, thanks to U.S. radio.
Yeah.
Is making it a hit. And they are actually the first ever guests on Conan, Late Night with Conan O'Brien.
Oh, wow, that's
cool. In September, they play Creep. And in September 93, almost exactly 12 months from its initial launch, EMI re-releases Creep in England, and it goes to number 7, and it is on.
Yeah.
It is on. The song starts to take over planet Earth.
Wow, that's so wild that it had to have a second life, essentially.
Yeah, it's so lucky, too. And the story, I think it really can't be overemphasized how, like, the decision of one DJ had such power. Like, that one choice that this gentlemen, Mr. Axelson's ears were like, "I really like this song. I just like this. I think other people will too." Sometimes, especially in this era where radio has become so corporate, we have this sometimes presumption that it's all algorithms and, focus groups. No, a lot of times it's just one person saying, "I like this," and having the power to play it on the air and other people like it too is what makes a song happen and what makes a band's career begin.
Coming up after the break, more Creeps, more weirdos, and an isolated guitar stem that will blow your head off.
Get ready. It's going to break your speakers.
Welcome back to One Song Luxury. I'm so excited to hear these stems. Let's start. What do you want to play for us?
Let's get into it with the drums. This is Phil Selway playing the drums. I just heard a song in my head. What did you hear? We hear the same thing.
Yeah, it's not "Pour Some Sugar on Me." It's one of those hair metal bands.
I'm gonna play it, and you'll be like, "That's the one."
"Loving in Elevators."
You're so close. You're so close. I want to play it before you get to it because you're halfway there. Yeah, it's the Aerosmith "Walk This Way" beat.
Walk This Way. What's funny is that you forget this song was, kind of composed probably in the late 80s, since you said he was still a student.
Yeah.
And those drums would have been perfectly in line with the music on the radio at that
time.
With
the Aerosmith Run DMC remake that had just come out. Yeah. It's so funny hearing
those drums don't kind of go with the vibe of the song. It's hilarious.
This is such speculation on my part. I'm just going to say it, though. I really feel like so much of this song is a goof. In other words, we've talked about this phenomenon. Sometimes you're playing something as a musician, whether it's your part or the song as writ large, and there's something about it that you know is a little bit maybe not corny, but there's something like cliche. That's the word I'm looking for. Mm-hmm. There's something done before, especially these guys. This is Radiohead, who make a career after this song of doing the unexpected. The chord changes, the time signatures, the like use of instrument, you know, songs without any drums.
I know.
All of that experimentation is about to happen in their career, but they haven't quite maybe gotten there yet. But I definitely think that playing that drum beat, they were maybe all winking a little bit. A little bit like, this is Walk This Way, isn't it? So when we get to the chorus, Mr. Selway unloads. He starts to loosen the hi-hat, and then he breaks into the big chorus beat. Let's hear that. But he's still playing the kick drum,
what's interesting, when you hear those cymbals, you realize it's kind of a slacky way of playing the cymbals. Like, it's kind of like
sloppy.
You can hear the self-loathing in the fact that the cymbal is not quite with the rest of the song. You know what I mean?
It's like, synecdoche. Each of the individual parts comprises the whole.
Yeah.
Even the ride cymbal is like, I'm slacking and I'm a creep.
It's like, I'm not happy playing the cymbal.
I'm a bad person.
But you hear that, right?
I do. Yeah. It's very lackadaisical. It's very slacker. Mm-hmm. Very Gen X. Oh, we haven't said Gen X yet. That's what we've been trying to get.
Oh, that's true.
This is a Gen X anthem.
Yeah, it is a Gen X anthem.
And then he has a couple fills here and there. Phil plays some fills. Oh, poor guy. I just ran into a guy called Justin in the hall, and the door was about to lock, and I said, thanks, you came just in time. And he goes, my name's Justin. Poor Phil. He hears that all the time when he's playing the drums.
They always say never make a joke about a person's name because they've heard it. Trust me, they've heard it.
Well, here comes Phil playing some fills. But that's it. Nothing more complicated than that. Not fancy. Simple. Strict tempo. He's doing his job.
But,
laying it down.
It's tempo, but he's selling the theme of the song with that cymbal.
Phil Selway is selling the song with his fill.
Gosh.
What are you doing, Diallo? What are you doing?
I'm just setting you up for pure jump
dad
shots.
Joke heaven.
No, exactly. What's the next demo you want to play for us?
Next up, we have Colin Greenwood on bass. One thing about this, before I play it for you, that I heard an interview with the producer, Paul Coldry, and while they were recording it, he was talking to Colin about, like, Colin was like, all right, not almost like an actor, what's my motivation? And he was sort of giving him some suggestions. He said, the verse is Al Green, the chorus is the Pixies.
Oh, wow.
I thought that was kind of an interesting insight.
Al Green.
Yeah, right? Let's listen if we can hear the Al Green in the verse. And here on bass is Colin Greenwood, also known as Johnny Greenwood's brother.
I can almost hear it.
You hear the Al Green?
Yeah, a little bit. I can hear it there.
It's a little bit of a syncopated note, little funk groove to it, but not like funky James Brown funk.
Yeah, I think if it had different drums and a completely different, totally different singer, I could actually see the Al Green in there. That's cool.
And here's Colin and Phil together, just so you can hear the full rhythm section. Playing in lockstep.
Mm-hmm.
They're doing their jobs.
Yeah.
Bass and drums, holding it down.
It's funny, when you don't have the drums in there, I'm like, oh, I can hear some Al Green. Once the drums are in there, there's no Al
Green.
There's
no Al Green.
There's no Green here.
There's a little bit of Aerosmith, strangely enough. I can't unhear the Aerosmith now. It's so funny. Just to take a step back for a second, the way the band, as I understand it, at the time, was writing songs, which evolved over the years. At that time, Tom York, the singer, is kind of the main songwriter, to the extent that, there's a funny quote I'll read in a second, but the songs usually began as Tom York's demo or sketch of an idea, which then he would work with Johnny. They'd be sort of the McCartney and Lennon of the band and harmonically develop it. Because what Johnny Greenwood, the guitar player, brings to the mix is like a very eclectic musical background. He loves jazz. He loves all the avant-garde stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And he's not necessarily like a virtuoso guitar player, as he himself would say. And when we listen to the guitar part, which we will next, you'll hear what he's playing is amazing, but it's not like technically insane. Anyway, what happened later on is the band started to become more democratic because Tom started to release his grip on the creative process, from what I understand. He even said himself that In 2004 interview, he said that his power used to be, quote unquote, absolutely unbalanced, and he would, quote, subvert everybody else's power at all costs.
Oh, no.
You know, I think this comes after being friends from childhood.
Yeah.
And, you know, they learn to live with each other as friends and bandmates. It's really important to mention that this is a band that has never changed its personnel. Radiohead has been the same five guys since high school to this day. They have solo projects, they come and go, but they're friends, and they've learned how to, like, share the challenges of power that come from being in a creative relationship together. So I really think that's a really interesting part of the story.
And I think you got some guitars for us, and we are very much looking forward to guitars.
Oh, man, I don't want to make the build-up too build-up-y, but I'm going to have to build up just for a moment, because there are two guitar players in Radiohead. It's Ed O'Brien and Johnny Greenwood.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm about to play the guitar parts. And we're going to hear The Noise, which is what they called it, in quotes. The Noise is what the band refers to this sound as. They knew how important it was.
Yeah.
When they were writing the song. Now, it's different stories about how it came to pass. I'll tell you the two main ones. And
yes,
it's for us, the listener, to decide what's true. Now, clearly, with the Pixies conversation we had earlier, they were going for that quiet, loud, quiet thing.
Mm-hmm.
So at one point, I think Ed is playing the chill part in the verse, that arpeggio with the no distortion on it. And Johnny's waiting for his moment. He's waiting for his moment to arrive. He's got the distortion ready to go. And according to the story, Ed says, he told NME in 1992, this is the sound of Johnny trying to fuck the song up. He really didn't like it. So he tried spoiling it, and it made the song.
It made the song.
Tom York, by contrast, tells the story, it's that nervous twitch he does, that's just his way of checking that the guitar is working, mm-hmm. that it's loud enough. And he ended up doing it while we were recording. And while we were listening to it, he was like, hey, what the fuck was that? Do that again. We're going to keep that. So either it was an accident or he was trying to fuck it up. Now, we may never know the origins, like the very, very, very,
very
first time
he ever did it. Yeah.
Maybe it was an accident. Maybe it was an accident that maybe it was something he meant to do to fuck it up that he pretended was an accident.
Yeah.
But certainly by the time they went into the studio, it was part of the song. It was part of the repertoire. It was how they did it,
mm-hmm.
as the producer explains. Like, that was just how the song was being done. So when you hear it in the song, that's not an accident. That recording of
it, of course, yeah.
is definitely purposeful.
Yeah. But the thing I love about it is that it does seemingly come out of nowhere.
It comes
you
out
know?
Of nowhere.
It's just like this big angry voice that just comes stomping onto the track.
It's massive, and it sounds wrong even though we know it's right and we're waiting for it because we're excited to hear it.
Ja-jan.
It just jumps out of the track. It almost sounds 3D, right?
I love it. I love the idea of him doing it to intentionally ruin the song.
Is that the explanation you want?
I think that's what I want to hear.
Yeah. Let's go with that one.
Let's hear it.
Okay, so let's start with the chill guitar part.
Is it Ed O'Brien?
It's Ed O'Brien on guitar, probably for the chill one. Certainly in the video, if you watch it, it's Ed O'Brien playing it.
I mean, that you could literally put that guitar part into a total rock, you know, total rock anthem. Like,
yeah.
you know, like it sounds like you almost expect, like, you know, Eddie Van Halen to come on the track. You know what I mean?
Right.
It sounds like a setup for a totally different song when you isolate it like that.
It even kind of evokes like an 80s power ballad. Again,
that's what I'm
that
saying,
they would be
yeah.
making fun of. If the drums were halftime, it's...
yeah.
It could be like a Guns N' Roses.
That's
like,
what I'm
you
saying.
Know, right.
It's so interesting when you isolate it and it sounds like a totally... So you got Al Green.
Yeah.
You know, a.k.a., you know... Al Greenwood?
Aerosmith.
Is that a thing? No, I was saying because it's a Greenwood.
Greenwood, yeah, maybe he is a band member,
yeah,
Al Green, in Radiohead.
But I mean, like, you know, you've got Al Green on one part, you've got Walk This Way on the drums,
right.
you've got, like, this 80s
Guns
power ballad.
Thing.
Yeah,
right.
On this guitar. There's so many different things, but when they add them together, it's creep.
It's something completely different.
Yeah.
Well, that continues throughout the entire verse. And then, you know, an interesting thing
What does
happens.
He do on the chorus? Because I feel like that guitar gets forgotten on the chorus.
On the chorus, he continues to play that, but we have the entrance of guitar player number two, Mr. Johnny Greenwood,
yeah.
who's lying in the wings waiting for his moment. And here is his moment.
Oh, Aw, come on.
What a satisfying ending.
I was just going to say, that ending sounds like the end of like a 90s sitcom to me.
Like, or it could be like a symphony. It's like the final satisfying note. Yeah. Again, and that's a funny, you're right, because like, to the point that I was making earlier, my theory that there's a lot of sarcasm or humor or wink wink or mm-hmm. irony going into the choice, not just of the song and the lyrical content, which we'll get to in a minute, but also each individual part. Like, it's kind of funny as a guitar player to end with
it's so sweet.
It's almost overly satisfying.
You know, those two guitarists, when you isolate them, doesn't it just sound like the 90s? Like, I'm old enough to remember what the 90s was like, and I feel like, gosh, I can literally see like the Castle Rock Entertainment logo come up. You know what I mean? I can see just this sense that like everything's going to be okay. And you didn't worry about everything that happened in the news. Didn't feel like an existential crisis that was, you know, literally going to, it all goes away obviously in 2001, but man, the 90s were kind of fun.
Wait, did I just sing The Embassy? What was that? What did I just sing? I just sang some VHS videotape intro thing that I've heard a bajillion times. Do you know what this is?
I don't know which one that is.
Super important. We've got to like pause the podcast conversation.
The other thing I really like about Johnny's guitar playing here is that it has almost nothing to do with the verse. Like, it just comes in out of nowhere. It announces its arrival.
Yeah.
And then it's just fuzz. It's just like
it's
this crazy rocking fuzz. And then it goes away again.
It's a two-bar chord. Dun, two, three, four, two, two, three, four. Dun. Dun. And then towards the end of it, he starts to do the sort of tremolo.
Yeah, I heard that. I never really heard that in the song before.
Yeah, I'd never noticed that either until we isolated
crazy. He came on the track. It was just like, my song now.
He's making it energetic. You know, I don't know if that's 30-second notes or a tremolo, whatever you'd call it. But that is his, at this point, I would call it his technique. When we get to the chorus, which I'll play it in a second, you'll notice that there really isn't a guitar solo to speak of. He's kind of doing that thing again. So it's melodic. He's finding notes, but it's not like a wailing guitar solo, which would be filled with lots of notes, and they would be very high on the scale and playing scales up and down and doing crazy stuff with whammy bars. He's not doing.
No.
We're coming out of the 80s. We're leaving the Eddie Van Halen,
Yngwie
Malmsteen era of things and getting into post-grunge, I guess was what you would call it.
Yeah.
Gen X music. Slacker music. God, I hate these expressions. Cringe.
We'll get all the buzzwords in there today.
So, interesting story I'm going to tell you about in a minute regarding another song with a similar chord progression. Now, one thing actually before I get to that is to point out that it is an unusual chord progression. The chord progression has, it goes from G major to B major, which is interesting because technically you wouldn't play a B major, you play a B minor. The notes of the same, I'm not going to go down the path of being too musicologically, you know, music theoretical, but that's an unusual choice, which is why in the second chord, it evokes a new feeling to the listener. It's like, oh, that's surprising. And then it happens again because the third chord is a C major, and then it goes to C minor. It's sort of the same principle.
Yeah.
I'm just going to take a very quick music theory detour, which is relevant to the song for two reasons. One, because it's going to explain a little bit why the song sounds simultaneously, you know, simple, but also surprising. And secondly, because it becomes relevant a little bit later on when we get to the interpolation part of our broadcast.
You knew it was coming.
You knew it was coming. I've got a guitar, which I'm holding. So everything you hear, mistakes and all, coming up on the podcast, coming from me. This is not the stems. Little moment. I've got the guitar here to discuss how the chords of the song Creep are. Starts with a G major. Then it goes to a B major. Now, normally, in the key of G, that would be a B minor. So you go. But in Radiohead's Creep, it goes from G major to B major. So emotionally, you know, without knowing music theory as a listener, you hear that, and it's kind of surprising. And part of the reason why is what I just explained. Then it goes to the C major. And then it does kind of the same thing again. It goes to another chord that wouldn't normally be there, which is the C minor. So that full progression is this. G major, B major, C major, C minor.
You came to the podcast for Creep, but quietly, it's all one big music lesson today.
before we leave the world of Johnny Greenwood, he not only played guitar on this song, he also plays piano. And there's kind of a funny happy accident story behind that, because he was recorded playing piano throughout the entire track. But back in the days of 1993 recording, before the sort of computer screen digital era, when you're mostly recording to tape and you had faders that were actual physical faders, if you forgot to put the fader up when you were bouncing to tape, the instrument on that fader, that instrument in that track, the stem, if you will, using our terminology, you wouldn't hear it. So they were bouncing a mix. Paul Coldery, the producer, tells the story. And as they got to the end, they realized that the piano part had been muted the whole time. It was a mistake. So the piano is in the song. It's at the very end, and I'll play that for you now. But it's just interesting to think that had he not forgotten to move the fader up, it would have been throughout the entire song. That was their intent, was to have this piano part the entire time.
Let's hear it.
Was that minor?
So good.
And it's sort of perfect because it feels conclusive.
Yes.
It's like a nice build to get.
Yes, I love the piano. I mean, again, this is one of those things where it's like, you want to think it's intentional because it works so well.
Right, to only have it at the end.
Yeah.
But that was just, they just messed up.
Oh, that's crazy.
Happy accident.
All right, we got our guitars, we had our drums. This is usually the high point, but after I had the cha-chunk, you know, I was good. But let's hear Tom's vocals. Kind of a hard song to sing.
Kind of a hard song to sing.
Yeah, I mean, like that part about she's running out the door, you know, I guess that would be the bridge. That part is really high.
It's very high.
I saw you singing that earlier, and I was like, oh, that's really high.
Yeah, you saw me trying to sing it. You heard me trying to sing it, and you're like, that's higher than Blake. <too."> Fair enough. Fair cop.
But let's hear Tom's vocals. What do you want to play for us?
Let's start with the first verse.
I wish I was special.
Don't worry, it's the PG version.
You're so very special. But I'm a creep.
You know what's interesting about that transition to the chorus is that vocally, he's not changing very much
no.
the way he sings. The guitar does all the heavy lifting
yes.
of making it go to like from 1 to 99.
Yeah, he doesn't go, but I'm
right.
a creep. Like
right.
he doesn't do that.
Right.
He actually is singing it pretty much the way he was
kind
singing
the
verse.
Kind of the way he was in the verse. It's not that much different. There's like a 2%, you know, change, which I think is for the best. I think if he was, what if it was the like, here, let's do it together. I'll just get, let's mute Tom and just belt it.
But I'm a creep! I'm a wet!
Nope. See, you don't want that. Nobody wants that.
It's a weird mood today in the studio.
Nobody wants that version. Did you want that version? I didn't like that version at all. Diallo was speechless with how much he disliked it.
We're having fun today.
Well, let's listen to what you were just alluding to. This is the second chorus. I'll play you the whole chorus into the what I'm going to refer to.
It's a bridge.
Yeah, but, you know, the Brits would call it a middle eight because they got a name for everything.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And here it is.
Run, run, run.
Wow, that's a note. Damn.
Okay, couple of things.
Okay.
First, if you were in the studio with us just now, when you hit that one note, our speakers started like crackling. Like, you know, it was like.
And Metallica has played in this
voice,
room.
I know.
Yeah.
Voice was just a little too much for the speakers here at SiriusXM. But more importantly, I didn't know what he was singing in that part.
Yeah.
And now I understand why, because he's singing She's Running Out the Door, but he sings it in just a crazy way. Can we hear just that line? Can you pull up She's Running Out the Door? Because he's doing so much on that lyric.
She's running out the door.
I mean, by the way, I feel like I heard some laughing on the track. Did you hear that?
You know what's happening?
I heard it
here?
Both times, and I thought it was our producer, Matt.
I can
Matt.
Tell you exactly what's happening.
What do
here?
I hear there?
You're absolutely right that they are laughing. I don't know. I didn't hear it in the track necessarily. I mean, that's really funny. But this is a tongue-in-cheek thing happening. I was speculating before about maybe the bass line's a little, I mean, maybe the drummer's thinking a little bit, oh, I'm being Aerosmith. Tom York was 100% consciously emulating something else, and I will now tell you this story because it's an expensive one. So what happened was, as they were playing the song, Ed O'Brien noted that these unusual chord changes he had heard before in another song. And when it was pointed out to the band where it came from, and I'll play you what it was lifted from in just a moment, Tom York doubled down on the connection between the two songs.
Oh, wow.
And okay. He's like, I'm going to sing the melody from that other song. So here's the song. It's called The Air That I Breathe by the Hollies, written by Albert Hammond, and that's right, father of Strokes guitarist Albert Hammond Jr. and Mike Hazelwood in 1972. This version is recorded in 1974, and it's the Hollies, The Air That I Breathe.
Peace came upon me and then peace.
Exactly. It's the same chord changes. They would have gotten away with it too had they only did the chord changes, because as we've talked about on previous episodes, cannot own chord changes. We're going to be talking about the Ed Sheeran case specifically a little on another episode, but that recently has demonstrated legally that you can't sue somebody for using the chord changes. Where they got in trouble was when they winked at each other and said, you know what? You're right. It does sound like the Hollies Air That I Breathe. I think I'm going to nick the melody for the chorus. And that's what we all kind of, we heard the smile on his face as he's singing the laughter. Unfortunately, it cost them a little bit of money. By the way, one more musicological thing for the day, and that'll be enough for the episode. The phenomenon of using the same chord changes, which I already know is not going to catch on like interpolation. But here's a new word for you. It's contrafact. So it's called
I don't like contrafact.
You don't like contrafact?
That is a terrible term.
Okay, well.
It sounds like.
I had low expectations.
Sounds like
for it
governmental doublespeak or something like that.
It's a very funny sounding word that I do not think is going to catch on. The whisper didn't even work with it. It's too many hard sounds. But when the same chord changes are used from one song to the other, it's referred to as a contrafact. It's obviously the basis of all jazz from one song to the next jazz standards.
What if you have facts about the Contras? It's going to cause confusion.
It does make me think of Oliver North and Ronald Reagan.
Exactly. People are always talking about the Contras. What year is it?
Just give me the facts. So originally that was a guitar solo until Ed O'Brien pointed out that the chord progression was the same.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, the quote from Greenwood about it was, it was funny to us in a way. It was sort of feeding into the fact that the chord changes were the same. So they were doubling down without maybe thinking about the copyright consequences, which did come to bite them a little bit later. Albert Hammond and Hazelwood's publishers did sue. But I found this fun quote where Hammond said in 2002, Radiohead came to them and said, you guys are right. You got us. You nicked us. We're not trying to like pretend it didn't happen. And Hammond, the co-writer, said, because they were honest, we didn't sue them to the point of saying we want the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
We ended up just getting a little piece of it. So it's interesting that the actual manner, the like tone in which they were approached of niceness, rather than saying, nah, like, like played into how much of a percentage they ended up taking.
Yeah.
That's not the end of the story, however.
What?
Of the chord changes from the Hollies' Air That I Breathe.
Okay.
Because one more song, one more artist enters into the equation, and that's Lana Del Rey with her 2017 song, Get Free.
This is my commitment, my modern manifesto.
So I don't know about you, but to my ears, I certainly hear not just the chord changes, but also the melody. And this is where it gets interesting, because Radiohead did file a lawsuit against Lana Del Rey for that song in 2018.
That's interesting.
So Lana tweets about it, and she says Radiohead is demanding 100% of the royalties to the song, which in a sense, like, I can see where they're coming from in a sense, because it is both the chords, which they don't own, but the melody, which they do, which is usually the basis for these lawsuits. That's that's your interpolation right there, is that melody. But I think what ended up happening, because they'd later dropped the lawsuit, I think they were shamed out of the lawsuit, or their publishers may have been shamed out of it, because it's a little bit embarrassing that Radiohead, being the band that they are with so much integrity, and having had this experience themselves being sued over the Hollies song, it's a little bit lame. And again, I don't think it's Radiohead. It's probably their publishers and their lawyers that are going after the 100%. They said that she had offered 40%, they countered with 100, it became this back and forth. At the end of the day, they're not listed in the official writing credits. Mm-hmm. I think they may have just dropped it all together.
Yeah.
They may have just been like, that's a little bit not our look. I think Radiohead may have stepped
in. It does
in
seem
and
a
said,
little off-brand.
It's very off-brand, and I wouldn't be surprised if the band themselves came in and said to the publishers, guys, this is
hey,
not
guys,
cool.
Calm
Let's
down.
Not do this.
Yeah.
Diallo, I don't know if you're going to believe what I'm about to say, but it's been 30 years since this.
Shut up.
No,
you're lying.
I'm not going anywhere. if you were going to say get out of town, I'm not going anywhere.
Oh, wow. 30 years is, that's really hard to believe.
Why do you
wow.
think this song still resonates after
you
all
know, I think it's just a really human emotion. We all feel that way sometimes, you know, I'm a creep, I'm a weirdo. I also, the line, what the hell am I doing here? I don't belong here.
That's,
I mean, like,
great line,
who doesn't
feel that way sometimes?
Who doesn't feel like they don't belong sometimes? There's so much pain in the song. Like, you know, the line, your skin makes me cry. Like, woof, dark, dark place. And I feel like, yeah, I'm going to say it one more time. Every time we come into the studio, we're talking about music that we love. And we love this song, but this song has, like, you know, some darkness to it. And I feel like it absolutely, you know, to have these kind of like lyrics flow over you, it's been an interesting day in the studio. So it's nice to know that they're not taking themselves too seriously, but this is a dark song and these are dark emotions. And that is something that, you know, music can sometimes accomplish. You know, sometimes we need that song that is too depressing for BBC Radio 1.
Well, I don't know. I hope this helps you feel a little bit better about the balance of the song's darkness with the sort of sense of humor you were mentioning that we found during the interpolated, the expensive part of the song for the band. Do you actually know the origin of the album title, Pablo Honey?
No, tell me.
It's so, these guys have a sense of humor. I don't think Radiohead gets credit enough for having a sense of humor. The title comes from this. This is Pablo Honey, which is a track on The Jerky Boys 2.
Ha!
Yeah, who is this?
Pablo Honey.
Ha!
You washing your ass, Pablo?
Who is this?
Keep yourself clean, honey.
Now, for people who didn't live through the 90s, it may be hard to
say,
explain
you talk
how
about
funny this was in 1994.
My college,
the Jerky Boys.
Everybody at some point was exposed to The Jerky Boys. It was just these guys who did, you know, prank phone calls, which doesn't work in the cell phone age.
right, because you didn't know
really
who was calling you.
Yeah, because you're not going to pick up that
pick
random
a number
night
out of the phone book at random and call somebody and say silly stuff.
And then they would record it and
put it on a CD.
By the way, the idea of Tom York sitting around listening to Jerky Boys is funny in itself.
Isn't that great? Doesn't it help lighten the load?
It does lighten the load.
Darkness?
But you know what? This song does have a lot of dark energy in it. And sometimes you need that darkness, and that's why artists continue to cover it. It's been covered by Weezer. It's been covered. Actually, one of my favorite all-time covers of any song is Prince performing Creep
at
Coachella.
Yeah. 2008.
Let's play a little bit of that. I think if you don't know this clip, find it on YouTube. It's outstanding.
Well, he sped up the chord changes. They happen twice as frequently. That's an interesting choice. It's pretty amazing it's watching this grainy footage from 2008.
Too. Oh, yeah. We all had the iPhone FOMO 2 back then.
So I got the FOMO for this one. FOMO for Daft Punk at Coachella. FOMO for Prince at Coachella. There's a lot of Coachella to have FOMO
for. Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Gosh, we miss him. Right. Okay, it's time for one more song. This is where we share a new song with you, the One Song Nation, and with each other. Luxury, why don't you go first? What is your one more song?
You know, this song is from, we're talking about songs that are from, you know, a number of years ago. And then when you look at the number of years, you're surprised because it didn't feel that long ago. This is a song from 2000, which I've recently been resuscitating, pun intended, name of the album, for my DJ sets because it sounds so good to me. It sounds so fresh to me. And if you listen to our previous episode about Rihanna, and I played for the one more song, I played my latest single, which is called Strangely Familiar. I was very inspired the last time we had a DJ night together when I played this song. This is Adult with a period at the end. It's Hand to Phone, the Cordless remix. I just love this track so much. Adult are a duo from Detroit. They use, I think, 606s and like old drum machines. They've got that pummeling 16th note marauder bass thing I talked about last time. And this just like right now, it sounds right to me. Even though it's a quarter century old, it feels really fresh to my ears. Diallo, what about you? Do you have one more song for us this week?
Yeah, for my one more song, I'm going to go back about 10 years. This guy out of the UK, Lyndon J, had a song called Be Like You. I really wish it had been a bigger hit. Both there and here, but I really dug it. This is Be Like You by Lyndon J.
Everyone out there wants to be like, drop another one.
I just love that song. There's something really hypnotic about it.
You know I love it when the chord changes are surprising. Yeah, I wasn't expecting that second chord. It's really satisfying.
As always, if you have an idea for one more song, you can find us on Instagram or TikTok.
And if you made it this far, I think that means you like the show. So please don't forget to give us 5 stars on Spotify or Apple Podcasts, leave a review, and share it with someone that you think would like the show. It really helps keep the podcast going.
It sure does. It sure does. Luxury, help me end this thing.
Well, I'm producer, DJ, musicologist, and songwriter and creep, Luxury.
And I'm actor, writer, director, and sometimes DJ Diallo Riddle.
And always weirdo. No, that's hey. Not mean. I was.
Oh, man, I'm out. I'm done with this.
I'm referring to the song lyrics, of course. And this is one song. We'll see you next time.